Next session is called Political Armies of the Right, but also of the Left. I begin with the first subsection, old-style dictatorships. Long before the Cold War, some countries in the region suffered from protected, tyrannical regimes with personal rulers. These dictators used the army, the political force, and the death squads to maintain order and to assure obedience. For instance, from 1933 on, Nicaragua was ruled by three successive members of the Somoza family who controlled the National Guard. The regime was shattered by a guerrilla movement in 1979. Guatemala was governed by successive military dictators from the 20s to the mid-80s. In El Salvador, short-lived civil military juntas sometimes interrupted decades of military rule from 1931 until 1979. The former army head of the Dominican Republic, Rafael Trujillo, governs the island as if it were its personal property. Also, the capital was called Ciudad Trujillo. In Cuba, a military strongman, General Fulgencio Batista, became the de facto president in 1933. After a short guerrilla campaign, and I'll come to that later, he was ousted in 1959. But in Paraguay, also an army colonel staged a coup in 1936. He was succeeded by another army man, Alfredo Stroessner, who governed under martial rule and was overthrown by a military coup in 1989. But then I give, that is number two, an avoidance of the formation of a political army in a very relevant country, Mexico. Strangely enough, Mexico, the country where during a profound social revolution, regular and peasant armies were engaged in continuous confrontations, the country avoided the creation of a political army. The military phase of the Mexican Revolution lasted the entire decades between 1910 to 20. The military campaigns morphed into multi-layered civil wars with different factions and agendas, emerging social and peasant movements and conflicting regional armies. The death toll in that conflict was around 10% of the entire Mexican population, 1.5 million victims. During the following 35 years, the political structure of the country was forged by military presidents in a kind of one-party regime. General President Lázaro Cárdenas, considered the father of the fatherland, molded the party in four sections: a labor section with the trade unions, a peasantry section with the national peasant organizations, a popular sector that was in fact comprising the public sector and the middle classes, and a military sector. Subsequently, the year after that, he suppressed the military sector and considerably reduced the political significance of the armed forces until the present. Third point of this section, the Cuban Revolution and the emergence of guerrilla movements. Even more important, probably, than the Mexican Revolution was the Cuban Revolution of 1959. A small guerrilla force overthrew a demoralized army and established a revolutionary government. Once in power, far-going reforms and nationalizations brought the rebels in direct confrontation with the government of the United States. The guerrilla army was quickly reconstituted in a forcible and pretty large regular army, in certain moments Cuba had the largest army of the entire Latin American countries, assisted by the Soviet Union. For the next three decades, the Cuban Revolution advised and supported and even trained small detachments, detachments of guerrilla movement in 14 Latin American countries. Cuba also served as a kind of general medical facility for the many wounded guerrilla combatants. And it also provided shelter to many exiles from the life, from the middle and from the left, especially during the period of the long-term military dictatorship in the region, and that will be the subject of the next subsession. Many guerrilla movements were initiated, by the way, by student movements, by splits of the traditional communist parties, and by the disillusioned military officers. But the most important factor that radicalized many young Latin American activists had to do with religion. The period between the 60s and the 80s were the heydays of the liberation theology. It became of enormous influence in the hearts and minds of large segments of the Latin American population. Its influence on the many emerging groups of Argentinian and Uruguayan armed left and the Colombian and the Central American revolution movements is undeniable. It is also certain that it had an enormous impact on the general public, the peasants' communities, and the student generations as a whole in that time. And then I come to the point of the number four, the institutional groups and political armies of the right, the Cold War dictatorships. Cold War was a period of persecution, repression, and civil war in the region. A new type of the military coup d'etat became customary, the overthrow of elected governments by armed forces as institutions, not by some army leader or a navy leader, but by the institutions as a complementary institution. The first institutional coup was that in 62 in Peru, but the most important, without any doubt, was the military takeover in Brazil in 64. It gave rise to a sequence of Latin American dictatorship, afterwards known as the national security regimes of right-wing military leaders where the succession in the military cabinet members was arranged by internal promotions within the armed forces. The military institutions of 11 Latin American countries established long-term military-led governments between 64 and 1990 in Argentina, Bolivia, Brazil, Chile, Ecuador, El Salvador, Honduras, Guatemala, Panama, Peru, and Uruguay. Many of these regimes were in war with their own citizens, persecuting enemies of states, from trade union leaders, organizers of peasant associations, and journalists to militarily operating guerrilla movement, and in some cases explicitly engaged in civil wars. Their ideology was that of a fervent anti-communism. The military juntas developed the full characteristics of political army leaders, governing as the legitimate stabilizing force and as a kind of last resort defenders of Western democracy by eradicating communism from their territory. Under the umbrella thesis of continental security, a complementary thesis of national security merged with the Latin American tradition of geopoliticians. Ultimately, they fought mostly internal wars against subversive or terrorist adversaries, real guerrilla movements, or imagined trade union members, priests, or nuns. In the case of Argentina, Brazil, Colombia, Chile, and especially Latin America, took the form of dirty warfare, state terrorism, including widespread torture, assassinations, disappearances, even amounting to genocide, and it was at least the conclusion of the Commission of Truth in Guatemala. Repression was meted out not only to deal with known adversaries, but also to instill fear in society as such. Central America had even a much larger number of victims than all other countries. The military muscle of dictatorship was based on three conditions. The first one was condition over the national system of intelligence and security forces. The second, the predominance of the military over the police forces. Third, the military missions of local and regional development in remote areas. Of these three factors, control of security and intelligence has been the most important. The internal wars against subversion were conducted by an array of parallel services, military intelligence, the security bodies, the police and the para-police bodies, and the paramilitary groups, including death squads. The dorsal spine of counterinsurgency operations, the intelligence and security systems, expanded to such degree that their official or unofficial ties with paramilitary units became difficult to distinguish. The use of paramilitary forces or as auxiliary deterrent and local enforcement could take grotesque forms. Death squads like the AAA in Argentina, two parallel military forces in El Salvador, and particularly the self-defense patrols, the PAX in Guatemala, terrorized the entire country during years. At the height of the counterinsurgency campaigns in Guatemala, the army forcefully incorporated more than 1 million indigenous civil patrol members, probably half of the entire indigenous adult male population out of a national population of 9 million. Also elected presidents of countries in guerrilla warfare made ample use of paramilitary formation. In the late 80s and the early 90s, during the entire 90s, during the counterinsurgency operations of the Fujimori government against Maoist guerrilla Shining Path, the Peruvian army eventually mobilized 400,000 indigenous paramilitary troops, ronderos, operating under the authority of local commanding officers. Their presence was the factor that, with respect to the victory of this guerrilla. During many years, the Colombian army made use of private armies, regional paramilitary forces that were finally unified under the umbrella organization of the Autodefensas Unidas de Colombia, and the most recent report of the Colombian Center de la Memoria Histórica, it's a report of 2013, attributes 70% of the victims of massacres to the campaigns of the army combined with those of the paramilitary forces. And then I come to another kind of military governments of the left, the reformist political armies. Military men were not always inclined to the political right, especially among the low-ranking young officers. One can discern revolutionary lieutenants and captains. In the 20s, there erupted rebellions by young officers who in later years were characterized as military youth in Brazil, in Chile, and Ecuador. Also in decades thereafter, military youth in Central America participated in rebellions with nationalist reformist agendas. In Guatemala, in 1960, young lieutenants with a similar agenda participated in an effort to overthrow a military dictatorship, and after its failure, they created the first guerrilla groups in that country. In 1981 and 82, young officers were instrumental in the overthrow of the two most merciless dictatorships that Guatemala had known, the President Generals Lucas Garcia and Rios Montt. El Salvador, they were the actors of the last two military coups against, in an effort, in a desperate effort to prevent large-scale guerrilla warfare. But even more, there is a sequence of government with nationalist, leftist, military leaders under whose command the armed forces implemented anti-oligarchic and anti-imperialist nationalizations in all poor governments. Many of them and the younger military ministers were of lower middle class or came from the precarious urban working classes. Elected Colonel Jacobo Arbenz in Guatemala in 1950 to 1954 was the first one who was elected president, maintaining his army rank and initiated the land reform, nationalizing American properties. He was ousted by the CIA prematurely. His political successor, the generals Velasco Alvarado in Peru and Omar Torrijos in Panama, carried out institutional coups in the same year, 1968. Both army chiefs were passionate nationalists and defined themselves as military reformers with a special mission to break the power of economic and political oligarchy, to restore national control over the economy, and to accomplish social reforms, executed and implemented by the armed forces. Military reformism was not restricted to Panama and Peru. Other armed chiefs followed suit and adapted similar, albeit more modest, programs. In Bolivia, Generals Obando and Juan José Torres between 69 and 71, and in Ecuador, General Guillermo Rodriguez Lara in 72. In retirement, several of these military reformists founded an NGO for progressive officers in retirement, and it will not be of a complete surprise that in the mid-90s, its president was the Venezuelan former Lieutenant Colonel Hugo Chavez.